On this episode of America's Port, the Port Police Dive Team sweeps the dock to protect incoming warships. The future of this shipping terminal.
How do you compete?
Depends on the arrival of these two massive cranes worth $15 million. But a rogue sailor breaches the Coast Guard security zone around the ship. And navigating the 200-foot cranes under the 193-foot bridge could be disastrous.
I don't know, it doesn't look that good from here.
The Port of Los Angeles, the nation's busiest container port. This city within a city was founded over 100 years ago. Today, the port is responsible for roughly one out of every eight jobs in the region.
The Port of Los Angeles is the engine of the Southern California economy.
95% of all goods entering the United States arrive by water. Products of all types flow through the port, appliances, clothing, electronics, and cars. Chances are good that something in your house came through the Port of Los Angeles.
It's America's port. This is America's port.
With billions of dollars in cargo flowing through the port, security is top priority.
We have to think about 9/11 and all the ramifications of that.
One agency charged with protecting this vital American resource is the Port Police. They monitor the entire port from the docks to the breakwater, an area encompassing 7,500 acres and 43 miles of waterfront. Today, a specialized unit of the Port Police, the Dive Team, embarks on an operation of national security.
We're going to be doing a pier search this morning. We have arrival of two Korean Navy vessels, a destroyer and a support ship. So we're just going to be checking the pier where they're going to be berthed for 3 days. Because of the sensitivity of the U.S. situation with South Korea, we just want to provide extra security. Anything that could be down there, explosives or, you know, obviously anything of interest.
You guys ready?
South Korea is an important ally, and protecting their warships is of vital importance. Divers are watchful for anything suspicious, including improvised explosive devices, or IEDs.
Deployed center of 46.
The sweep could take close to an hour. The team constantly stays in contact with their topside support crew.
409 topside Edwards, radio check. Roger, topside copy.
Searching the dock where the warships will berth is a challenge to the team.
The Port of Los Angeles, the water conditions, it's low visibility. That's just the nature of the beast. It's our working conditions here. And we have an experienced dive team, so they're accustomed to that. It changes how they operate, but these are normal conditions.
IEDs come in various shapes and sizes. They are made from easily acquired agricultural and medical supplies. A remote control or a tripwire detonates the device. If the dive team members aren't alert, they could accidentally set off a device while performing their search. The dive team pays close attention to the pylons of the dock, meticulously scours the floor, and carefully inspects anything atypical.
Got everybody up.
They've completed their dive operation. So we will retrieve the divers from the water two at a time.
A lot of sea life down there.
Yeah.
We didn't find anything. So it was a great dive. Everybody's back safe.
Max, hey, would you let them know that all seven divers are up?
I think the importance is a high profile that we're protecting the port's assets and that we're also protecting incoming vessels that are here on welfare visits.
The dock is clear, but the mission isn't complete yet.
I treat this escort like any other escort in the sense that every escort's important. Essentially, berth 46 is clean, so a vessel will remain here on security. The warships will be here for several days, and the port police will operate perimeter security with the United States Coast Guard 24 hours a day until the warships leave.
Across the harbor, a battle rages at the Port of Los Angeles. One of the smallest of the 27 terminals, TRAPAC, struggles for survival. Leading the crusade to save the terminal is TRAPAC's Vice President, Frank Pisano.
In 2002, we had 11 accounts, 11 different steamship lines come into TRAPAC. Now they have three remaining accounts.
Business is being lost to the Goliaths of the port, such as APM, a terminal nearly three times the size of TRAPAC and with the ability to handle the newer, supersized cargo ships.
Now the ships are 18 wide versus 12 to 13 wide in the past.
Compared to their competitors, TRAPAC's facilities are woefully outdated.
How do you compete? We have already started the layoff process. We just have to get the improvements done.
Pisano has petitioned the harbor's board of directors to approve his expansion plan.
TRAPAC currently occupies 175 acres in the Port of Los Angeles. With our expansion plans, we'd be going up to 235.
Most importantly, expansion means larger cranes that can offload more cargo in a shorter amount of time.
The new cranes will be able to go higher and further for the wider ships that are coming in.
The future of TRAPAC hinges on an upcoming vote by the port's board of directors. 2 years ago, Pisano took a huge and secret gamble to save his terminal. He ordered two larger cranes for $15 million. They took 2 years to make and will handle the larger ships. Otherwise,
I can't pay the rent. That's why it's critical for us to get that production up.
Today, on the day of the boat, they sit outside the harbor after arriving from Japan on a special ship. If the board doesn't think there are enough environmental measures in the expansion plan, these cranes won't be allowed to enter the port. There'll be $15 million worth of scrap metal, and TRAPAC will be doomed. The day of reckoning has arrived.
President Freeman?
Aye.
Vice President Lopez Mendoza?
Aye.
Commissioner Kim?
Aye.
Commissioner Krause?
Aye.
We have four yeses and that's no noes.
Oh, it's adopted.
TRAPAC wins approval to expand. But that was only half the battle. To get to TRAPAC's terminal, the two cranes must pass under the Vincent Thomas Bridge, followed by a wide left turn into the narrow channel, then a sharp right turn into TRAPAC's terminal. The problem? The cranes stand 200 feet high from the waterline to the top of the A-frame. To make the voyage, they were folded down to approximately 189 feet. But clearance on the bridge is 193 feet. The brightest minds at the port convene to flesh out the details of this formidable task.
Port's multitasking this procedure.
189 feet.
We're going to be really close.
Are we planning on closing the bridge?
One transit, we did shut traffic.
Do you need any kind of special lighting or anything like that?
How about the Coast Guard?
There may be a petty officer that'll probably accompany you guys.
Security zone around the ship and have a blue light escort. Cover all our bases so there's no surprises when we get in there.
Charged with guiding this precision operation are port pilots Mike Rubino and John Betts.
The assignment we have is to go outboard the Dock Express number 10.
The captain of the Dock Express 10, also known as the Dockwise, navigated his ship from Japan to the edge of the harbor, but he will relinquish control of the vessel to Rubino. No registered vessel enters this port without a Los Angeles port pilot taking the helm. The normal practice for a port pilot is to be taken out to the incoming ship by a pilot boat. The ship will not come to a halt for the pilot, so he must grab hold of a slick rope ladder and scale up the side, all while the ship bears down on the harbor.
I like to think of it as the shipmaster. He knows his ship very well. That's his office. Our office is here inside the harbor, and together, the shipmaster and the pilot, working as a team, make sure we have a safe passage to the dock. The cargo aboard today is kind of special. We've got two cranes that we're offloading for the Port of Los Angeles, and the transit will take us underneath the Vincent Thomas Bridge, which has a clearance of about 193 feet this afternoon. So when we pass underneath the bridge today, we'll have about 4 feet of clearance, if all the calculations are correct, and we're hoping they will be.
Transport will occur at 5 p.m. when the tide will be at its lowest point.
We have to make sure that we have low tide perfectly. It has to come directly down the center. 5 degrees either way, we're in trouble.
This is Captain Betts. He's going to be riding along the ship. And we're going to have him climb to the top of the A-frame on the crane, which is going to be the highest point above the waterline.
We've done all the calculations, so the crane should fit under the bridge. But for something that's critical, we want to make sure. So I'll be up there to get a visual check to make sure we've got enough clearance to move the crane under the bridge.
What I don't want to hear from him, or what's going to cause us to stop, is we don't have the clearance and pull full on the tug, stop the ship from moving forward.
If the cranes hit the Vincent Thomas Bridge, the first crane could tumble into the water, taking Betts with it. The second crane would be pulled into the harbor by the first crane, putting Trapac's $15 million gamble at the bottom of the main channel. Communication between the man at the helm of the ship and the man on top of the crane is critical. Choosing Betts was a natural. These two were former college roommates.
Our relationship, John and Betts and myself, goes back to the opening formation, 1973, at the California Maritime Academy. And I remarked he was about 20 pounds, 30 pounds lighter then. He was still tall and skinny, that he looked like a stick man. And the stick man name has stuck with them all these years. So stick man's going aloft, and hopefully he'll be able to stand up and clear the bridge when we pass under it.
Timing is critical. Passing under the bridge at low tide could increase the clearance between the bridge and cranes an additional 2 feet.
About another hour and a half, it'll be zero tide going down.
The Coast Guard will act as escort for the ship. They must be prepared for all contingencies, from a coordinated terrorist attack to a simple situation with a rogue boat.
We're escorting a huge crane through the main channel underneath the Vincent Thomas Bridge. We protect the ports, and we do a lot of safety zones around these like important structures, like anything on the pier, anything that's actually with any high-value asset.
The two $7.5 million cranes on the Dockwise represent the future of the Trapac terminal. An attack on the ship would hinder Trapac's future, shut down the port, and cripple the nation's economy at a cost of $1 billion a day. Trapac's $15 million investment waits to be boarded by the Los Angeles port pilots. The men will steer the 200-foot cranes under the 193-foot Vincent Thomas Bridge.
Good afternoon. Captain, we're heading your way at this time, and the pilot's requesting if you would just move up the three shackles there.
bring that gangway up a little bit?
Port pilots Mike Rabino and John Betts make a safe transfer from the pilot boat to the dockwise. The Coast Guard remains watchful for anything suspicious.
We're just doing like a round of the boat just to see if it's safe. Once it gets underway, it's gonna be a 200-yard like security zone off the bow itself and 100 yards off each side and the stern.
Z3, dock express.
Z3.
Port bow, captain, one line.
Rabino takes command immediately, giving orders to the crew. He doesn't physically drive the ship. He just directs the crew.
Captain, can we have ship radio on 73 and 13, please? And we can go ahead and take the tug, port bow, and starboard quarter, tug line.
This is Tim Quinn. Go ahead, Mike.
Hey, Joey. Good afternoon. Have you guys working aft.
Okay, Mike, we'll take a look at it.
Captain Joey Blanks is at the controls of the tugboat Tim Quig. The 3,800 horsepower tug is responsible for steering and stopping the dockwise.
It will be like his brakes, and we can also push him too. So we're gonna be a push-pull kind of mode. We can also help him turn if he needs to go to the left, to the port or to the starboard. That'd be right or left, and that's gonna be basically our job.
If things go bad, the tugs are the only vessels that can prevent the cranes from crashing into the bridge.
You just really have to pay attention to small details out here, and you know, just be careful and go slow. The worst case scenario in this whole job is if we do hit the bridge, doing damage to the bridge, and also possibly losing one of these cranes in the water. It could be really devastating to hit that bridge for all parties involved. So we don't want to do that. We don't want to old back full, you know, we don't want that.
The tallest port pilot begins his ascent to the top of the cranes. It's a treacherous climb that will take him up 189 feet, almost as high as a 20-story building.
Dead slow ahead, too.
Dead slow ahead.
Both engines.
Condensation makes the surface wet and slippery. And there's no safety net.
So that's the high point right there, huh? Okay. Excellent. This is the spot. I'm looking right at those lights. Yeah, this is the spot. I'm finding the spot where I can sight right to the horizon over the structure. See, it's just even with the horizon there, right from here. And then I know I'm looking exactly level, rather than up or down. So if I stand here, I'll be able to see the gap exactly between the cranes and the bridge.
We're gonna have to clear that day marker up there, Captain, for the shallow water.
Yeah, I don't want to run in there now.
We're crossing in front of the LA gate right now into the LA main channel. And we're about 3.5 miles from the bridge at this point. Anybody hear from Stickman on top? That's kind of not good. Stickman, are you on this side?
I'm on here, we're up here, everything looks wonderful.
We got a good perch.
We were wondering, you didn't call us. We're starting to send out a search party.
I was enjoying the view, it's so breathtaking that I just forgot.
Roger that. We're a little ahead schedule, so I've cut her back just a bit.
Okay, we've got a real good spot here where we can sight exactly how much clearance you have as you approach.
I don't think I've ever been this high up going through the harbor before. It's a whole different perspective.
the Coast Guard 41-footer you see that's off the port bow, and also the Los Angeles police boat, and then we have another rib boat over here. We had about three escort Coast Guard and LA police boats that are keeping traffic clear of us in the channel. We don't want to make any sudden maneuvers for small boats crossing our bow. We want to keep this ship in the middle of the channel and tracking on course. So those boats have created a security zone around the ship to keep small boats and vessels that really don't have the word that we're moving out of our way.
The big ships in the port share the waterway with smaller pleasure craft. Suddenly, two sailboats breach the security zone. The ship's machine gun escort rushes to intercept. Just inside the seawall, the Dockwise and its cargo slowly make its way toward the bridge. Two sailboats have trespassed into the security zone. The Coast Guard races across the harbor to cut them off.
Yeah, there's a couple of sailboats out in front of us that we're basically making sure they don't breach our 200 yards.
Just be advised, there's a 200 yard security zone around the crane ship behind us and 100 yards on the side and stern. So just be advised when you're in the channel that this ship's gonna be coming through. Appreciate it.
The sailboats disperse. But a bizarre radio call puts the Coast Guard on alert once again.
Seal, I'm coming in fast and hard.
Fast and hard.
Sir, where are you right now? Where are you coming into fast and hard? Where are you right now?
Now, I'm looking at the gate and the angel. Gate?
You're coming in angel gate?
And four.
Okay, there you go. We'll be waiting for you.
Vessel Recycler, Coast Guard 331, Channel 12, over.
While one of the escorts breaks away to search for the source of the distress call, the Dockwise creeps toward the Vincent Thomas Bridge.
We're in the middle of the channel. Speed is under 4 knots because we've got less than 2 miles to go, and we want to be there in about 30 minutes. So we're getting everything settled down so we can make our arrival around 1700. Center span of the bridge.
The only advice our boss gave us before we left was don't f*** it up. I think he's more concerned we f*** it up than die, actually.
You can't see anybody.
Good, we're tracking pretty well. We can't see you. Can you come to the edge without falling off?
Yeah, they're looking good.
Yeah, we got a nice perch up here.
Yeah, it's getting cool up there.
It's a little chilly.
We'll be fine.
Okay, I got to cut way back to just under 4 knots because we only had about, we got about 1.6 to go from here, so I don't want to get there too early.
Okay.
It's imperative that the crane ship gets to the bridge at the lowest of low tide, precisely at 5 p.m.
Mike's killing a little time. Let the tide go out a little more.
A couple of minutes early or late, and the calculated clearance under the bridge will be off.
I don't know, it's gonna be close. We'll see. I know I'm not gonna be able to stand up while we go through, that's for sure.
Okay, yeah, we're beam berth 233 now, and we're easing it up there for probably a 1700. We're gonna be in position to pass under the bridge.
Roger, make that call to CHP now.
The California Highway Patrol needs to stop traffic on the 2.2-mile Vincent Thomas Bridge. Vehicles traveling across the bridge weigh it down, depriving the Dockwise of valuable clearance space.
And what they're going to do is have a bridge closure when we pass under the bridge. Just another level of safety. And also, the more cars you put on it, the bridge sags a little bit. So if you keep the weight off the bridge, we'll get that much more clearance.
We're still a little bit too far away to
tell if we're gonna fit under the bridge or not. I'll have to get around this corner and get squared up with the bridge, and then I can be able to tell better if we're gonna fit or not.
At the offices of TraPac, Frank Pisano tracks the progress of his $15 million venture.
We have over 250 cameras that we could zoom anywhere around the terminals. It's critical for them to make sure that they not only have the width of the crane, but the height of the crane cleared for all the obstacles they're looking at.
At the other end of the port, just inside the break wall, a Coast Guard crew searches for a boater who radioed in an unusual call. He reported his location was inside the seawall near the Dockwise and its $15 million cargo. The Coast Guard vessel is armed with the latest technology that will help them find the mysterious boat.
We can use a direction finder. If they talk on the radio for a long enough period of time, we can look at our direction finder to see what his bearing is relative to us. It sounds like he's right outside LA Gate right here. And if he is anywhere near the gate, we should get a visual on him pretty soon.
The elusive boater contacts the Coast Guard once again.
This is the Coast Guard on channel 1-2, go ahead.
Yeah, this is 4529. He is in Hogan. Edwards, he is in Cat. We're stationed here in San Diego Harbor.
Something's not right. If he's inside the harbor, the Coast Guard should be able to spot him.
Now he's saying he's safe and secure in San Pedro Harbor.
As the cranes approach the bridge, the Coast Guard continues searching for the boater. If he is safely moored, there are three possible marina areas where he could be docked. At any moment, he could decide to move into the channel and into the Dockwise path.
What is your location? Do you know your exact location right now?
We're inside the seawall.
So you've already come inside to the break wall?
Good morning.
Hey, could that be him, 050?
Off our bow?
Yeah.
It's not their guy. He's still out there somewhere. Then another boat appears on their radar, just 500 yards away.
He's been telling us that he's 20 miles away. He's been telling us that he's inside the break wall and that he's moored up. And he's taking up all kinds of stuff, so it makes our job even harder when we're trying to locate someone like that. We don't know where they are and they're passing bad information.
They got him right there, flashing this blue light at us.
As the Dockwise moves down the channel, Rubino discovers the bridge isn't his only obstacle.
LA Pilot, Dock Express 10.
Dock Express 10, LA Pilot.
We're just about a beam of Bert 230 now, and there's a crane is still down at China Shipping. Could you give them a call, see if they can pick it up? Steady.
Okay.
Thank you. Dock Express 10.
The crane poses a major problem for Rubino. Maneuvering this 11-ton ship down the narrow channel is difficult enough. Rubino needs to begin his turn while under the bridge. If he swings too wide, the crane and lowered boom arm could smash together.
Here's the cranes of China Shipping's berth. And you can see our cranes, and it looks pretty close there.
B3. Well, we're down to about the last 500 yards, and we're creeping ahead at about 3 knots, about a fast walk.
The problems keep mounting for Rubino. Traffic on the Vincent Thomas Bridge hasn't been stopped.
thought they wanted to stop the traffic, but...
They look like they're still going. Stop two.
Stop two.
Stop both engines. Dock Express to Port Police.
Roger, update on traffic.
Okay, we're proceeding.
Roger, give me a minute to lock it down.
The Dockwise is at the bridge on time, but traffic still streams across. A crane boom is down, and a rogue sailor still eludes the Coast Guard.
What is your location? Do you know your exact location right now?
Captain Rubino.
Go ahead, John.
I don't know. It doesn't look that good from here. We'll see.
In the main channel of America's port, the Dockwise slowly inches towards the bridge. But traffic still streams across. The extra weight could lower the estimated clearance an additional 2 feet. If the cranes hit the bridge, Trapec's $15 million investment and Stickman could plunge into the harbor.
Okay, John, I got both engines stopped. We're drifting and clearance looks good.
Mike, I'm watching it. My same spot. Carl, it'll go a little better when you get closer.
Roger. P3, stop and drag.
Okay, we're pleased to dock right. Yeah, the traffic is stopped at this time.
And we'll be under the bridge in about 10 seconds. Thanks for your cooperation, guys. Appreciate it.
Still looks good, Mike.
Roger. Looks like we're right in the middle. Just got her drifting.
The pilot up on the highest point of the crane just gave the pilot up in the bridge the go-ahead to go under, so we're proceeding. So the pilot's picking up the speed on his ship. He's up to 3.6 right now.
Now I'm looking right at the green light.
Can you touch it?
Yeah, too far away. I will be able to, though.
We're in right dead in the middle. It's 1 minute after 1700. We are here, so it looks good.
That looks like it's gonna get jammed from my ankle.
Still looks good, Mike.
John, let me know when you pass underneath.
I will. You're looking real good, Mike.
It's going to be close for the 6'6" stick man as he measures the clearance. Clearance is of particular interest to Rubino, who had a wager with Stickman.
54 inches. I think I put 52. I think I lost.
For Frank Pisano, the job is only half over.
Our next critical stage is to land those cranes safely on dock.
How are we looking for swing?
I'll let you know when you're clear.
Roger.
The tallest point of the cranes clears the bridge.
Stop port. Hard to port.
Now, Rubino has to start maneuvering for a tight left turn toward the Trapec terminal. But the lowered boom on the left could be in the way and poses a major hazard.
The job is not done yet, so we won't pop that champagne for about another 30 minutes.
A distress call diverts one of the Coast Guard vessels from its escort mission of the Dockwise. the vessel carrying the $15 million future of the Trade Pack shipping terminal.
Yo, I'm coming in fast and hard.
Fast and hard.
Sir, where are you right now?
When the crew responded, the boat wasn't in the area.
Can't spot him anywhere around here.
Information from the boat has been unreliable. They spot another boat on the horizon.
I'm gonna block his wind. Huh? Where's it? I'm gonna block some of his wind. This is the guy.
Yeah. How you doing, sir? You all right?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Are you the only person on board, sir?
Yeah.
Where are you headed? You trying to get back inside the break wall?
Actually, we want to get gas and go to Marina Del Rey.
He fits the description. He might have just been confused.
Okay, hold on a second here.
The Coast Guard still doesn't know the man's state of mind. His bizarre behavior over the radio keeps the men on alert.
Have him drop his sails and we're going to tow him to Cabrillo. On board? Yes, all right.
Sir, can you drop your sails, please? We're gonna tow you into Cabrillo to the scope here, all right?
Sir, do you have any weapons or anything like that on board? Guns, knives, anything like that? What's that?
Yeah, Mario.
Do you have any weapons or guns?
No.
Okay. Careful, sir. Oh. Hey, Rex, get us over there.
Draws pepper spray for his own safety.
Sir, come back out here, okay?
They will protect themselves at all cost.
Hey, listen to me now.
Well, you asked me to lower a sail.
Sir, you all right? Have a seat right here, please. Sir, have a seat right here. You want to tell them on the radio? All right, sir, we're gonna take you in. We're gonna take you into the fuel pier, all right?
Due to his erratic behavior, the man is handcuffed.
Sir, you're not under arrest. Just don't resist me, sir.
I really don't want him to jump in the water, especially it's not that rough right now, but the water is really cold right now. It's about 58 degrees. All right now, lifeguards are gonna throw a tow line over. Man's just taking him over the fuel pier.
The seemingly drunken man's vessel is towed into shore. His ordeal is just beginning as the port police await his arrival. At the Vincent Thomas Bridge, the cranes have almost passed completely under, but a difficult task still remains.
The job is not done yet. We have to swing these cranes around the lowered cranes at berth 100. We have to be very careful that we don't hook one of the cranes on our ship with the booms that are hanging over into the channels.
Oh, careful. Are we gonna clear it or not?
How are we looking for swing?
You can swing, Mike. You're gonna be clear just a moment. You got a lot more room on the next one, good 6 feet.
Roger, here we go. Dead slow ahead, starboard.
Dead slow ahead, starboard, engine.
Z3, flare it out a little bit. Give me an easy pull.
We passed another obstacle, and they have one more turn to make, and they're gonna come down to our channel.
We got it.
Thank you very much.
Very good. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Very good. Touch the bridge, huh?
Hey, stick man, Nice job. I know it's a good view up there, but come on down. Thanks.
Okay, Mike, you're done with us. We'll come down.
Fuel change comes to the starboard console.
Each job is unique in its challenges. That was the unique challenge for this job, getting the ship safely under the bridge, everything working as it should, and it did. It went like clockwork. It was great. Tim Quig, Joey, we're going to let you go there. Come on over on the port side, same spot on the other side.
There's always pressure until you get the thing tied up and everything secured. The job's not done until it's tied up and secured and everybody's happy. The pilots are happy and the captain on the ship's happy.
The Dock Express 10 final berthing assignment is right off our port bow at berth 136. Stop port engine.
Stop port engine.
You can see that I was yellow.
Looks good, Captain. Yeah, you just walk right across.
Stop engines.
How's that?
Better is not possible, pilot. Spread down, okay. You can give all the wires.
So we're gonna spin. Done. Yeah. Thank you. It was a pleasure, Captain. I enjoyed that. That was a lot of fun. Thanks a lot.
Oh, I know. We just don't want you to fall over, right?
The Coast Guard tows the sailor's boat to shore, where they'll hand him over to the port police.
You been drinking today, sir? A little?
Alcohol and boating is a deadly mix. Alcohol use is a leading factor in fatal boating accidents.
We're gonna bring him in and we're gonna give him a field sobriety test, and pretty much the port police is gonna take over with the arrest process.
Sir, we're gonna conduct a boarding on your vessel to ensure compliance with all federal laws and regulations. Is the paperwork on your boat?
Current. As current as you can be.
What, your registration?
Yeah. No dude.
When was the last time you were boarded by the Coast Guard, though?
Let's see, I think the thing says 9309 or 08, 07, whatever. There's a new one. You guys just f***ing did it. You've done it three times in the last year.
Where's the registration at for it?
On the boat.
Where on the boat?
Where it belongs.
Safely ashore, port police meet the sailor.
Be advised, port police on scene with us now, and we're moored up at the Rio launch ramp, over.
We're just doing a boarding on his vessel to ensure his vessel's complying with all federal laws and regulations.
The man is as cooperative in person as he was on the radio.
You put me in handcuffs for God only knows and you wrecked my keel. So explain that.
Well, we're gonna conduct some tests now.
A sobriety test is given.
I just need you to blow in here until you hear a click.
I've already witnessed you stumbling.
Well, let's see.
I smell alcohol on your breath.
I'm in handcuffs. 7
on the pass, so I am placing you under arrest for 655, boating under the influence. Do you have anything else to say?
Yes.
Okay.
You guys screwed up.
Getting him in the police car is as difficult as getting him off the seas.
Do not move again.
I didn't move the first time.
Did.
You yanked me.
No, I did not.
Oh, no, you did not.
But it's all in a day's work for the agencies defending America's port.
Sit down. Ouch.
Gee, can you hit my head a little harder, please?
Sit down.
We finally got to his location, and it was pretty obvious that he'd been drinking. Wasn't real coherent. It wasn't making a whole lot of sense. Had no clue where he was. Didn't know where he was going, and didn't have a great awareness of his surroundings.
Thank you. Today, a massive effort kept commerce flowing and the waterways safe at the Port of Los Angeles.
Everybody did a great job. For our engineering people at the Port of LA who reconfirmed everything, the tray pack people, the law enforcement people, Coast Guard, it was one huge team effort and we pulled it off. It's really good to see that come together.
As a result, Frank Pisano and Tray Pack look forward to a successful future.
This is step one of our rebuilding of our terminal to get us up to a state-of-the-art terminal.
The two new cranes majestically stand 200 feet high. The sky's the limit at America's port.